Curious about the cure of the year? Let's be vaccine updated with me right now. What's up? Delsie Martel Vicente here, providing you Med Remedy. This is episode 3 of the 4-part series CoronaV, Upclose, and Evidence Base. Today, we will be talking about the most awaited cure of the year, the COVID-19 vaccine, and how scientists around the world are doing to find it, as well as when will it be available. As of August 13, 2020, the COVID-19 cases around the world is 20,836,617, of which 6,359,292 are active cases. Despite the containment efforts and social protocol reminders, the world still failed to bring the COVID-19 pandemic under control. The Philippines, for one, is again under modified enhanced community quarantine in selected areas. Hence, more and more people are placing their hopes upon 160 vaccines simultaneously being developed across multiple countries. But what is a vaccine? A vaccine programs the immune system to remember a particular disease agent by allowing it to practice or train in a weakened, killed, or altered form of a pathogen. This is called primary immune response, where the immune system encounters the pathogen for the first time. And since the vaccine is a weakened, altered, or killed version of a pathogen, the body can easily win against it. And the wonderful thing is, the body keeps a battle report of cells who win on that particular pathogen. Those cells who survive the war becomes memory cells. And memory cells have secret weapons called antibodies. These antibodies work like a lock and key, specific for a particular pathogen. For first-time contact, it takes 5 to 7 days for the body to make those. And that's too long for the body to fight back. Hence, vaccines makes it easier by allowing the body to be exposed to a pathogen it can easily kill, the body remembers it, and when the real pathogen enters the body in the future, memory cells will recognize it, and the body's response and antibody production will be much faster and stronger. This is called the secondary immune response, wherein large amounts of antibodies are produced in a shorter time compared to the first time encounter. And there are different kinds of vaccines. The two most common types are the inactivated vaccines and the live vaccines. Inactivated vaccines contain pathogens that have been killed either by heat or chemicals. One example of that is a COVID-19 vaccine under development known as CoronaV. The good thing about these vaccines is that they contain the whole but non-replicating virus that can stimulate the immune system really well. And the downside is they are hard to make. Manufacturers need to grow them in a lab, kill them, then make vaccines out of them. It's a slow process. And the immunity generated by these types of vaccines tends to fade over time, hence the need for booster shots. Live vaccines, on the other hand, are made of pathogens that have been weakened or attenuated. They are so weak, they don't make you sick, but they still make your body think it's infected and sets off an immune response. The good thing about these vaccines is they create long-lasting immunity. But the downside of it takes a long time to grow and weaken the virus. So it's safe enough to be used as a vaccine. To speed things up, vaccine developers are inserting certain sections of the coronavirus genes into live yet weakened versions of other viruses such as the adenovirus. One example of such is the Chagas 1 and COVID-19, which is now undergoing phase 3. Now, these two types of vaccines are part of the traditional approaches. Today, I'm particularly excited by a new approach that some of the COVID-19 candidates are based. And they are gene-based vaccines. Rather than a live or an inactivated organism, gene-based vaccines uses DNA and RNA. In the case of the coronavirus, they are using RNA, specifically messenger RNA that is responsible for the spike proteins of the virus. The virus depends on these spike proteins to break into cells and replicate. These mRNA are then injected into the body, where it is taken into the immune cells, and where it instructs these immune cells to make copies of spike proteins, as if they were infected by the coronavirus. Other immune cells will then be exposed to the spike proteins, and they will learn about them and train to recognize and block that specific spike protein. So when the body gets exposed to the real virus, the virus, who depends on spike proteins to break into cells, will be blocked and won't continue to spread. What makes it different from the traditional approach is you don't have to grow the virus, weaken it, alter it, then make vaccines out of it, as it is time-consuming. Instead, we get the essential information from the virus, give it to the patient, who then turns their body into their very own vaccine manufacturing unit. Because RNA vaccines let your body do most of the work, they require less material, hence much easier to manufacture. An example of this type of vaccine is Moderna, who just took 42 days to be created. It is now undergoing phase 3. But the downside about these gene-based vaccines is that they are largely experimental. There's never been a gene-based vaccine that is approved by the Food and Drug Administration. If a gene-based vaccine makes it, it would be the first of its kind. Okay, so when will this cure be available? Dr. Anthony Fauci thinks it will take around 18 months to develop a new vaccine. Although 18 months seems a long time, this would be the fastest time scientists have created a new vaccine. Development usually takes 10 to 15 years, but since we're in a pandemic, time is of the essence. The time frame now is cut shorter to 12 to 18 months. Preclinical research, which involves studying the biology of the virus or bacteria, its structure, how it infects, how it replicates, is now shortened to 6 months from the usual 2 to 4 years. After preclinical research, a vaccine candidate will be developed and will undergo preclinical stage. Preclinical stage involves tissue culture, cell culture, and animal testing. This stage assesses the safety of the candidate vaccine by allowing researchers to find out the safe starting dose, the safe method of vaccine administration, as well as its ability to invoke an immune response. This stage usually takes 2 years, but is now cut short to 6 months. Once the vaccine candidate provided good results, it will now move up to the next stage, which is the clinical or human trials. The clinical or human trials is divided into 3 phases. Phase 1 usually involves a small group of healthy people, usually between 20 to 80. This phase assesses the safety of the vaccine candidate, as well as the type and extent of immune response the vaccine can provoke. If phase 1 is successful, it moves to the next stage, which is phase 2. Phase 2 involves a larger group of people, around 100 to 1,000, and this time it's not just healthy people involved, but also those with underlying health conditions. Those with diabetes, cancer, heart problems, lung problems, hypertension, etc. The goal here is to find out the candidate vaccine safety, immunogenicity, the number of doses, schedule of immunizations, etc. If everything goes well with phase two, it moves to the next phase. Phase three involves thousands to then thousands of people. Apart from vaccine safety, vaccine efficacy is tested as well by determining if the candidate vaccine can prevent the disease, prevent infection with the pathogen, as well as produce antibodies or other immune responses related to the pathogen. All these phases of clinical trials usually take up to 5 years, but for the COVID-19 human trials, they are set to be completed in 1.5 years by overlapping phase one, phase two, and phase three. Once done with phase three, approval for use by the national and international health authorities will then follow, and it will take 6 months instead of the usual 1 year. Vaccine manufacturing, another important stage of vaccine development, will be fast-tracked to 3 to 6 months instead of the usual 2 years. How? By overlapping it with the clinical phase three trial. And finally, vaccine distribution will then be accelerated to 1 month instead of the usual 6 months. Hence, by the summer of 2020, hopefully the vaccine is out. But while speed is essential given the rise of COVID-19 cases and death rates around the world, the question is the vaccine safe amidst all the acceleration it went through? Although the phases of testing is done in an overlapping manner, it didn't compromise the safety when it comes to the development of the vaccine, because researchers and scientists constantly publish their data and journal reports backing up the trials, and this guides the development of the vaccines. If these evidences are strong, then scientists can be confident that they can do it in a rapid way. However, let's all be cautious, because not even the best scientists in the world have perfect knowledge to be able to predict all outcomes, most especially long-term outcomes. There is always risk and unknowns that are waiting to be solved, like how long will the immunity last, how many doses should be given to ensure full immunity, will these vaccines work in older patients because the older you are, the less effective vaccines are, will the virus mutate in the future, and will this vaccine still be effective against them? All these questions are yet to be answered. So let's stay updated in these vaccine trials and fight the fakes circulating against these vaccines. And while we wait, please don't forget to wear your mask, wash your hands, and practice social distancing, because COVID-19 is here to stay, and it won't be the last pandemic that we will all face. So we need to follow containment efforts and social protocols to reduce our active cases here in the Philippines. So don't forget to check out my video about stealth transmission proof, as well as hitting that subscribe button for more updates. If you got questions or comments regarding this video, feel free to type them down below. I'll see you next week on another video about CoronaV, Upclose, and Evidence-Based.